It is not true that I intend to give my concluding remarks at 4:30 a.m. We have quite a bit of material. But I think we'll get through it somehow. First of all, I want to say that the title of my presentation is The Classical War Against Multiculturalism, Brahms's Compositional Method. And that's what I'm going to discuss this evening. It is the purpose of my presentation to identify what constitutes universal culture as distinct from any centrist conception of culture, be that Eurocentric, Afrocentric, Sinocentric, or egocentric. Centrism is a noise word for what we previously called racism. The centrist theory entertains the idea that everyone in the human race should have his or her own theme park, or his or her own designer cage in a human zoo. And this human zoo should be ruled, according to population control experts like General William Draper, by a force that will become, and I quote him, quote, the park ranger for the human race. Many people are completely confused about the idea of universal culture and universal history. For example, a college student asked me during the spring of last year, who would write this universal history, since everyone who would write it comes from a particular background? My response was, that depends on whose universe you think it is. If there be universal laws, then they exist in each section of the universe in the same way. Their manifestations may be different, but the law is the same. If these laws can be known to be true and demonstrated to be true, they are science. It is the communication, transmission, and improvement of these laws which is universal history. For example, there are many languages, but the whole human race uses something called language for the purpose of discovering universal law. Wilhelm von Humboldt states that, quote, the bringing forth of language is an inner need of man, not merely an external necessity for maintaining communal intercourse, but a thing lying in its own nature, indispensable for the development of his mental powers and the attainment of a worldview, to which man can attain only by bringing his thinking to clarity and precision through communal thinking with others. And he goes on and he says, the mental power that intrudes from its inner depth into the course of world events is the truly creative principle in the hidden and secret evolution of mankind. Lyndon LaRouche has referred earlier in this conference to the exponential growth in population which followed the Council of Florence and the Renaissance. It is important to identify the fact that the people of the Italian Renaissance spoke a language that did not exist 200 years earlier. That is, it didn't exist in the 1200s, but was invented by the poet Dante Alighieri. Dante, who lived from the year 1250 to the early 1300s, struggled to invent a language that could resurrect the most profound ideas of human thought, even if his own era should commit suicide. This suicide, in fact, did occur through the banking collapse of the 13th century and 14th century, caused by the Bardi and Peruzzi families. Without Dante's gift of the Italian language, which was shaped by him from over 1,000 local dialects, there could not have occurred the Renaissance. Dante's Divine Comedy refined what was called the canto form of sung poetry, his particular poetic form. His follower, Francesco Petrarca, sought to advance the language further with the invention of the sonetto, or sonnet. But Petrarca's friend Boccaccio was assigned by Petrarca to a different project. It was called the Decameron. The Decameron was written in order to prevent the whole of Italian society from sinking into cultural pessimism and dying out during the bubonic plague of the 1340s and later. The Decameron consists of satirical stories, many quite bawdy and risque, which recount the tragedy of Europe's suicide in a way designed to make people laugh at themselves and repeat the stories and hopefully not the behavior which had destroyed them. Thus they would learn Dante's Italian. Geoffrey Chaucer from England attended a lecture by Boccaccio on Dante in 1375, and he got the idea to do the same thing as Boccaccio had done in English. Thus was born the Canterbury Tales, which recount the often bawdy and hilarious tales told on a religious pilgrimage to the Church of Canterbury. The English, being every bit as licentious as the Italians, also repeated the stories and thus learned how to speak English. Later, Shakespeare imported the sonnet of Petrarca into English. Your literate English is largely Italian, a sort of grandson of Dante's Italian. Later, the Christian humanist figure Erasmus of Rotterdam inspired his student, Francois Rabelais, to do for France what was done for Boccaccio for Italy and Chaucer for England. Thus was born the astounding character Gargantua, and with him the French language. Gargantua, for example, explains to the French population 30 to 40 ways in which the posterior may be wiped, finally settling on the warm neck of a goose as the best means. You can bet that this story got repeated all over Paris. And in Spanish, as Elizabeth has already said, we have the great example of Don Quixote, the knight of the sad countenance, and his sidekick Sancho Panza, a peasant and proud of it, who later on gives up being governor of an island in order to get a good meal. He was simply too Sancho-centric. In this way, languages created by poets lifted up the populations that had been dominated by ignorance and thereby ruled. In fact, the nations were created by the languages, not the other way around. The same project was carried out in the field of music. Musicians hear not a particular language, but the music of language itself, its prosody. Brahms and Dvorak, among others, were able to hear in this way. The idea that such a universal experience of hearing language is possible is attacked in a recent piece that appeared in the New York Times, written by Richard Tarushkin. And this is now a quote from that piece. This was a criticism of Dvorak, or the recent interest in Dvorak. Quote, as quoted by the critic Henry Krebel, Dvorak urged that his pupils submit the indigenous music of America, namely Indian melodies and Negro spirituals, quote, to beautiful treatment in the higher forms of art, unquote. But as usual, what is most significant about this prescription is what is allowed to go unsaid. The, quote, higher forms of art that would justify and canonize the national were themselves considered not national but universal, or to put it as a modern linguist would, unmarked. Yet they were national all along. They were German. Mrs. Thurber's conservatory, like all 19th century conservatories, this is the national conservatory at which Dvorak worked, like all conservatories outside the German-speaking lands, was an agency of musical colonialism. Dvorak was brought in to direct it, not as a bohemian or a nationalist, but as a master of the unmarked mother tongue, end quote. So this is the Times reporter who was trying to claim here that what Dvorak was doing by telling his students, his black and white students of composition, that they should use these musics and elevate them, that this was imperialism. For those who might not know, this is completely opposite to the way that Dvorak is usually described, which is, in fact, as a multiculturalist. What causes this writer's concern, Tarushkin's concern, is that there is a body buried that he hopes that we don't discover. It is the still living, faintly breathing, but living, presence of the transmission of classical culture to the shores of America. Actually, there is nothing controversial in Dvorak's advice. Bach, Johann Sebastian Bach, used folk themes and popular songs in his music all the time. The cantata Jesu meine Freude, for example, is taken from a bar song, Liza meine Freude. Haydn and Mozart both wrote several such compositions. Beethoven wrote over 200 songs set to Irish, Scottish, and Welsh texts, as well as piano and flute variations set to Russian, Tyrolean, Scottish, and other themes. Franz Schubert made great music accessible to every household with a piano by perfecting the art song, or the Lied, which had been invented by Mozart. Bach and Haydn had also written precursors to the Lied, the art song. You heard that last night, sung by Robert McFerrin, the Dichterliebe of Schumann, for example. Schubert wrote over 600 such songs and was followed by Schumann and Brahms. Brahms extensively utilized folk songs and themes as, for example, in his Hungarian dances. Dvorak did the same with his Slovenian dances. There was never a break, in short, between classical composition and the transformation of popular music through its laws, because these musicians were engaged in the same language project that the poet Dante had involved himself in. They studied poetry and wrote music to elevate us, to improve us, because that is the nature of the artist. He is us at our best. It was simply this that Dvorak recognized in his discussion and collaboration in America with the singer Harry Burley and other African Americans and white Americans who performed scores of spirituals for Dvorak. Burley saturated Dvorak in this music. Let us now explore how the classical composition method was transmitted to America. And in order to do this, we're going to do some performance for you, and we're going to first investigate a bit about Brahms. So I'd like to have John Segerson and Monica Ripamonti perform for you the Vegan Lied. Can I have the first transparency as they go to the piano? Let that go. This is also known as the lullaby. You all know this is the Brahms lullaby. And it is, I just read the words. Good evening, good night, bedecked with roses, adorned with clove pinks, sleep under the blanket. Tomorrow morning, if God so wills, you will be awakened again. Tomorrow morning, if God so wills, you will be awakened again. The second verse, good evening, good night, guarded by angels. In your dreams, they will show you the Christ child's tree. Now sleep blissfully and sweetly. Look at paradise in your dreams. Now sleep blissfully and sweetly. Look at paradise in your dreams.
Thank you.
this piece was written before Brahms had gone to Vienna. He met a singer from there by the name of Bertha Faber, who performed many of the songs of the countryside for Brahms. He set this song to utilize a particular rhythmic motif that she sang for him in the form of a waltz, and it's what you hear in the accompaniment. Monica, could you just play for me the accompaniment, the beginning, so people can hear that by itself? This song is so well known today that many people believe it to be either A, a folk song, or B, an adaptation of a folk song. It is neither. But in exactly the way that Don Quixote became a figure of folklore in Spain, and Gargantua such a folklore figure in France, so Brahms achieved the same with this song. Can I have the next transparency? He uses the interval of a third. When you, Kristen, you circle the first measure, the very first. People. The very first, no, the very first, yes. That's what I want. The interval of a third. And also the vocal principle of registration. We're going to look for a moment at the bass line. Chris, can you show people the bass line in the first measure? Now please circle that. Okay. We have the tones in the bass line. Three notes are an E flat, then a G and a B flat. Now, if these were played in the same vocal register, they would sound completely differently. Monica, could you play for me now the that bass line with the treble, with the C, E, and B? I'm sorry, the E, G, and B. Yeah, play the top, yeah. Know, play it together as though you were now changing the bass line to just, you know. Here's what would happen. I'll just play it. If you change the bass line to just make that tone in the same vocal register. Can you now play that the way it's written? So I think you can hear the difference. What has happened is that you have taken the G, the middle tone, and you have moved it into a higher register. And so the bass line has a living vocal quality. Now, the second thing I want you to note is that the singer enters. Okay, yeah, thank you. The singer enters after three measures, and he enters, or she enters, at a different place than we have seen so far. And for this example, John, could you help me out here? I'd like you just to sing the very beginning. I want you all to note that the tones that the singer is singing, the guten ab, the first tone is repeated, the G, and then you go to B. They are exactly the same as the very first two tones sounded by the piano. Those two tones are the same as the tones sung by the singer, except that there are three notes, with the first note being repeated. Okay. Very good. That's all I need. Now, some of you know that if you sing this in English, this is often sung differently. It is sung usually with this third, or sometimes with the third, missing. And it is sometimes sung as we use like this. That's the way that people do it, many people do it, who sing it in English, which is completely different. And the difference is that when you do that, you fill in the middle tone. You don't have this third. And what occurs is that the poetry of the song is now offset. This sort of musical element, which we see here in this very simple example, of the bass line, the piano opening, and the vocal line, gives us three distinct voices. I also will just point out the fact that the very first notes intoned by the piano are on an offbeat, so you get this rocking rhythm as a result. Because you have that offbeat, that makes the piece achieve this rocking rhythm. The text of this song is taken from a collection of poetry known as Das Knabe Wunderhorn. It was a popular album of poetry, folk songs at the time, that was a collection done by Friends of Brahms. We see a second example of the use of folk music in the first intermezzo by Brahms, Opus 117 in E flat. Monica's going to play the beginning of this, but I want to point something out that many people are unaware of. Can I have the next transparency? You're seeing the musical score there, and all I wish to show you is that in the top right-hand corner, there are some words written there, if you can point that out. And I will tell you what those words say. They say, this is an English translation I'm giving you, "Sleep softly, my child. Sleep softly and beautifully. I am very sorry to see you cry." And they are taken from something called the Herder's folk songs, the Scottish songs. So this is a motto to a instrumental piece done by Brahms. And Monica's going to play you the beginning of that piece now. This is in the same key as the Brahms lullaby. Monica? Thank you. Now, here we see the way in which a poetic text can be used as a model, or motto, I should say, where you could use also the word motif, to stimulate the musician. It also demonstrates the vocal root of so-called instrumental music. And we should hear, in a certain sense, a song without words. This idea of song without words points to the place where language originates before it is spoken. And what the musician is doing is that he's using there's a prompter, so you won't see words written there along the text. But this is the thought object of language, which is being played. It is what Edgar Allan Poe referred to as unthought-like thoughts, which are the souls of thought. So this shows you that that instrumental music, what you call instrumental, sometimes called absolute music, has a vocal root. The third example that we're going to use is a song which some of you heard if you were in the Constitution Hall concert, which is called Nachklang, or Echo. This is also written by Brahms, and we're going to hear this performed by Monica and John. And they will also do the beginning of the companion song that immediately precedes this, just the very beginning. These are two separate songs you're going to hear. You're going to hear a full song, and then you're going to hear an excerpt from the song immediately preceding it. These are sometimes called the Reagan Lieder. Before they go to it, can you please put up the transparency? I want people to know the words. So to Echo, the words are, raindrops are falling from the trees into the green grass. Tears from my dulled eyes are moistening my cheeks. When the sun shines again, the lawn becomes twice as green. My hot tears will burn twice as fiercely on my cheeks. My hot tears will burn. Now you'll notice that you have two separate poems set with the exact same music. You heard only the beginning of the second piece, which precedes it in the cycle, but I played it that way because we're going to be talking about the Nachklang for a bit. I'd like to, however, have my first tape example. This is from the third movement of the Opus 78 in G major by Brahms. This is a sonata for violin and piano, and this was performed by Gunter Ludwig and Norbert Breinin in Boston back in 1987. So could I please hear the first tape example? Now, I think you could hear it's the same exact theme, same exact music. And what we see here now is that there is the same music used for two different poems and for the third movement of the sonata. If you can run that slightly ahead and get me to my second musical example, I could use that. I'm going to now go to the piano. Can you put the next graphic up? And what we're going to do is we're going to look for a moment at how Brahms, what it is that he is using to compose this song. And we're going to look at really two elements. I want to say what they are before I go to the piano. We're going to be looking at the two lines of poetry. My German is not too good, but we're going to make the best of it here. Regen tropfen aus dem Baumen, sorry, fallen in das grünes Gras. That's our first line, and then Tränen minor starts my second line. You see that we've circled here the notes. We've circled the first three notes there, then down the next section, go to down, and we've circled them then. Huh? And what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you why we circled these notes at the piano. So this is the theme that you've heard. Well, that's the singer's line, huh? Well, what's happening there? You're using a note. The C sharp, the note that's circle, what you hear there repeated. This is used as a pivot. And you go up, can go to the next measure there and show them. And you come back down to it, and then you go down. come back. Huh? The note, the C sharp, is used as a pivot. But how far up do you go and how far down do you go? Well, you go up, you go now to the third measure, to an F sharp, okay? And then you go down, go to that measure, to a G. Huh? The space is an interval of a fourth. And the point is that the so-called tone is being used as a pivot. So, now, there are other intervals inside of that. I'm not addressing that at the moment. But I simply want you to see the use of the tone and the repeated note. Now we go to the second set of circled notes. Chris? Yeah. Now, that note is a half step above. Okay? That's what he does there. So you have the first C sharp at the top. Chris? And then you have, and that is used to introduce the second line of poetry. So the first line of poetry has three repeated C sharps. The second line of poetry has three repeated Ds. What the interval of that is a half step. The smallest interval that you can have on the piano, huh? Or you can have in the musical system. That's the interval you're working with this. How do you make that sound lawful? Well, you can do this. Okay, can I go to the next page, please? And that's what you see circled here. So what Brahms has done is he's taken two lines of poetry. And he is trying to show you, in these two lines of poetry, he's using musical elements to figure out a way to combine these two lines in your mind in a single instant. And what he does is, in this so-called cadence in the piano, which is really not a cadence, huh? He brings together the two lines of poetry that he has set musically using tone. Now, my point in showing you these examples, or this particular example, is that the idea of music is completely one of conscious mind, making decisions about how ideas of beauty are to be conveyed. There is nothing in music which is simply so-called irrational inspiration. No such thing exists. But it is hard work. It is hard work in which the idea is to select, by means of looking at a poetic text, the most appropriate, single, and most, shall we say, austere, simple musical elements that can cause this this conveying of meaning. And that is the idea. And that is the idea that Brahms was working with. This was a method of composition which Brahms had meticulously worked through over many years. And Dvorak, Antonin Dvorak, who was younger than Brahms and became a kind of a protege of Brahms, was fortunate enough to work with Brahms on this method before he came to America. When Dvorak was born in 1841, Brahms was born earlier, I believe it's 1833. And when Dvorak was about 35, 36 years old, and he was basically very poor, Brahms assured that Dvorak got a scholarship from Vienna. And for about 4 years, he was responsible for Dvorak basically being able to survive, and he helped him get his music published, he helped him get his music performed, and when and before Dvorak went to America, Brahms had many discussions with him. Dvorak often came to Brahms' home, where he, the violinist Joachim, and many others met and discussed music. Go back up. Now, I won't need the second musical example because I've already covered it. What did Dvorak hear in the spirituals? Let's give an example. I'd like to go to tape 2. And this should be, I hope, Roland Hayes. Okay. Could you just start that over? I want to make sure everybody hears this. This is Roland Hayes, who is performing Swing Low, Sweet Chariot. This is sung without any accompaniment. What Dvorak heard was that he heard beauty, and he heard it in the spirituals. He heard in the spirituals the idea of the living God, of the image of the living God. For that is the content of the spirituals. Then they can only be sung properly if that is, in fact, what they convey. Now, we will go to the next musical example, which is taken from the beginning of the New World Symphony. Now, often when people talk about Dvorak, they talk about how he took something or other from one of the particular spirituals or whatever. And there's a tendency in America, because of the way in which he's been used and abused, to see it more or less as movie music. What we're going to do, therefore, is we're going to play you the opening of the Symphony No. 9 from the New World into the section which Harry Burley, among others, argued was reminiscent of the Swing Low, Sweet Chariot. We'll play you up through that section. It's about a 4-minute section. And then we will say a little bit about this theme and about Dvorak's own view of the spirituals. So could I have the tape number three, the New World Symphony? Okay, fine. so that's said to be Swing Low, Sweet Chariot. Well, it could be. Maybe it is. It could also be something different, because after all, this rhythm is not in Swing Low, Sweet Chariot. This, right? This is there. So that's there, but what about this? Okay, well, you can say it's faster. But maybe it's this. Some of you know that that's the Schubert fifth. Well, it's neither one. It's both. It's not any of it. The point is, it has nothing to do with it. It's not related. The important point, I just want to find what I say here in the text to stay with this. We are hearing either or both or neither, because it is the intervals and the use of them powered by a single poetic idea that is distinctive. And I want to now show you the great trick played by Dvorak, which is the final musical example I want to use in this section, which was this. Some of you know that Dvorak was said to have taken the second movement of the symphony from a spiritual, which is called Going Home. Actually, it didn't happen that way at all. What happened was that Dvorak, as Harry Burley talked about it, saturated himself with the spirituals. Burley would sing to Dvorak for hours, and Dvorak would just ask him questions. And then what would happen is that Dvorak would go work. And the next musical example is the Largo from the Second Symphony, from the same symphony. And I'm going to play you what is sometimes said to be a theme that was set with the image of Burley's voice in mind for the Largo of the second of the symphony. So can I have that musical example? I believe that's tape one. Got it? Okay. here Dvorak achieves what Brahms achieved with the vegan lead and Rabelais and Cervantes achieved in their works, Gargantua and Don Quixote, because he was able to successfully confuse many, many people, even to this day, who believe that what he did was lifted this theme from a spiritual, when in fact the spiritual was written afterwards. It was the other way around. And that is really sort of the essence of what this entire presentation is meant to say, that there is an identity when one looks at the elements of language and the elements of poetry between what is called folk poetry in its elemental form and the highest forms of art. This is found and can only be found by an ingenious person who seeks to elevate. And that's how you transform a series of brutish dialects into a great, vibrant, poetic language. By the way, the translation into Czech of New World would be Nový Svět. In Dvorak's time, this was the popular name of a village area at the outskirts of Prague where people came to listen and dance to folk music. This may explain why Dvorak often joked that, despite the fact that many in America and Europe who were music critics couldn't seem to understand why he called the symphony From the New World, he said that any local Czech villager would have had no problem with that. Whatever his problems may have been, Dvorak had an understanding of the classical method of composition and conveyed that to his students as practiced by Brahms, and as that method was conveyed via Brahms from Bach through Beethoven and Schubert. I want to say one thing here, and we have a few transparencies just to sort of end with a group of the cast of characters here. One remark that Dvorak had made was this, quote, "It is to the poor that I turn for musical greatness. The poor work hard, they study seriously. Rich people are apt to apply themselves lightly to music and to abandon the painful toil to which every strong musician must submit without complaint and without rest. Poverty is no barrier to one endowed by nature with musical talent. It is a spur. It keeps the mind loyal to the end. It stimulates the student to great effort." Can you go to the picture of Dvorak? Look at that. "Thus it was natural for Dvorak to seek to convey the best of himself and of universal culture to those whom he met, who best represented in their struggle for freedom and the inalienable rights of man that universal culture." Now we're just going to give you sort of the movie wrap-up, so to speak, the cast of characters. This is Antonin Dvorak, who was trained, by the way, in his youth to be a butcher, but he showed greater promise as a musician. He was a street violinist for a while, but then he got some training as a organist and pianist between the age of 16 and 18, and after that he studied more or less on his own. Next, transparency. Now Johannes Brahms came from what we would call today in America the ghetto. Can we have the next transparency? Here's a picture of his house. Okay? That's where Brahms was born, in Hamburg. I don't know how many of you can see that, but that's a several floor tenement. Many of us recognize that automatically. His father was an above average musician. His mother, who had made her living as a seamstress, was able to quote significant sections of Schiller by heart. Brahms supplemented the family income by playing the piano in bars when he was 13 years old. He was significantly self-taught. Obviously, neither Brahms nor Dvorak were from the elite of German or Czech society. Next transparency. Neither was Frederick Douglass. His story is well known. What is not well known about Douglass is that he was an accomplished amateur violinist who learned to play while still a slave, and he played regularly Mozart, Haydn, and also Schubert pieces. Next transparency. Douglass's sons, like their father, fought for the freedom of their country in the Civil War. And this is just a picture of two of Douglass's sons. One of them was a sergeant, and one of them was a private in the Union Army. Next transparency. Douglass's grandson, Joseph Douglass, was an accomplished concert violinist. Here we see him and his father. He and his father often performed pieces by Mozart and Schubert together for recreation. Joseph Douglas was trained at the New England Conservatory of Music and then went to Europe. At the age of 24, he played at the White House for President Grover Cleveland. That was in 1893. I should also say that he had a very close friend by the name of Will Marion Cook, who was also black, who was a violinist who had studied in Europe with Joachim, and who had been heard by Brahms, and probably also by Dvorak before he came to America. I don't have proof of that at the moment, but I do know about his extensive training. Also, Will Marion Cook was a student of Dvorak in America at the National Conservatory of Music in New York. Next slide. One of the people with whom Joseph Douglas performed, in particular that concert at the White House, was Elizabeth Joyner Jones, or Ciceretta Jones. She had been prevented from singing at the Metropolitan Opera because she was black, but that did not prevent her from being one of the featured performers in a concert given in January of 1894 by Dvorak, which featured her, Marion Cook, Maurice Arnold, and many other African-American artists, together with just the other students of the conservatory. And that concert took place in the Scottish Rite Hall at Madison Square Garden. Next, transparency. The inspiration for much of this came from a woman by the name of Jeanette Thurber, who had come up with the idea of creating the National Conservatory and had successfully had legislation passed in America in 1891 to have that conservatory built in Washington. This was passed by the U.S. Congress, but it was never acted on. Next, transparency. The person that trained this was the site, the former site of the National Conservatory. This is not the conservatory. This is just something that was built on the site. And some of you read my article concerning the fate of Dvorak's house, so you have sort of a sense of the fact that people wanted to obliterate every trace of the conservatory. Next. The person that taught Dvorak the spirituals, Harry Burley, also told Dvorak a lot about slavery because his grandfather had been a slave. Next, transparency. And his grandfather had served as a captain on the Underground Railroad. This is a picture of Harry Burley, who's on the far left there, with his grandfather, who, as I said, Hamilton Waters, who was a captain on the Underground Railroad. So it's clear that Dvorak was appraised of much more than the spirituals when he was here. I'd like to simply say in closing that the purpose of my having gone through this presentation and given you this brief look at the way in which this classical culture was transmitted and was in fact held as a sacred trust in America is that when we look at people like Marian Anderson and when we look at people like the great Robert McFerrin, who is with us here in the conference, the point is to understand that as far as America is concerned, the universal culture, which is classical culture, was bequeathed to it by a group of men who were completely committed to uplifting the human race through beauty. And the fact that was bequeathed to the poorest, to the former slaves, was probably more what irked, more what irritated, more what enraged, more what terrified the oligarchy of the time than any other act. It is to that the fight against multiculturalism using the classical compositional principle of Johannes Brahms should be devoted. And that is the purpose of much of the work in music of the Schiller Institute. Thank you.